All right, so we get a lot of crazy ideas here, and I'm coming with maybe even a more crazy idea. We train rats to save human lives by detecting landmines and tuberculosis. I brought a live rat here. It's not really a live one, but it's actually an example of a giant rat. And that's what we train. We train giant rats. And this may seem really crazy to you, but actually it's an example of what the professor in D school earlier expressed. This is actually a good example of a design process. Because this may sound crazy to you at first glance, but in practice, if you look at the situation, the context in which these rats are used, then it may make a lot of sense. All of this approach is actually based on the empathy, based on putting ourselves in the situation of subsistence farmers in Africa, families like these who actually cannot access their farmland, they cannot fetch water, it's perilous to fetch water, it's perilous to fetch firewood because of the danger of exploding landmines. And really, it brings us to the problem. Most of these communities at the bottom of the pyramid, living in Africa, Latin America, Southeast Asia, they're actually affected by undetected threats. And tuberculosis is one of those threats. Landmines is another one. And these two particular threats, this organization I founded, APOPO, is working on. Because we believe that it is possible if we utilize resources in our own environment that we can come to solutions which are much more sustainable than what is often imposed from outside. And let me go at once to how this system works. Actually, here you see one of our trainers. He is in a safe area on the side of the road, and there's a landmine a bit here on the side. Actually, the animal smells it, and it wants to get there, but it has to follow the search pattern and to systematically search the field without leaving any blind pockets behind. And you'll see in the next row, actually, the animal starts scratching on the soil. I'm not sure there is sound, but what you should hear now is this sound, which is a click sound, and the animal actually comes back for a food reward, which is banana or peanuts. Very simple. These animals work for peanuts. So, why using rats? Well, first of all, these animals are endemic to Africa. They are giant African pouched rats, and you find them all over sub-Sahara Africa. They have more genetic material allocated to olfaction than any other mammal species. They don't rely so much on audition or sight. They actually mostly get their perceptory input through smelling. And it's something they start immediately after at birth. This is what the animals actually look like when they're 28 days old. Then they open the eyes, and then we immediately wean them from the litter. We socialize them. We bring them in all kinds of environments, expose them to different sounds, different smells, different people. They drive around in a car, they go with the trainers wherever, and they learn that humans are friends. Really important, because if the animals are well trained, they can be very sociable, they can be very intelligent, they can be very reliable pets, they can be even very clean pets. In a next phase, when they're well socialized, we actually start clicker training, we call this click sound, a simple metal clicker. And we pair this click sound with a food reinforcer. In this case, you see mashed banana in a syringe, but we also use pellets, we use all kinds of primary reinforcers, the food. And these animals love to perform repetitive tasks in return for a simple food reward. I think all of you have seen already a hamster in a cage that is happy by running around in that wheel for hours. And in a way, well, we should be grateful to the animals that they want to do this work, because it's landmine detection is a task that requires high concentration. Most of the problem occurs in very hot areas. You have to wear a lot of protective gear. It is really a difficult, dangerous task. And rats can help us enhance it a lot. So back to the training. Once this click and food is associated with each other, we can start now shaping the behavior of the animal. And you can't see it well from the picture. Actually, on this one, you can actually. There are three holes in the cage. The animal actually learns to put its hole in the its nose in the hole for 3 seconds, which is really long for a rat. And every time it does that, it gets again a click sound and a food reinforcer. And under that hole, we can put a target scent. In case of landmines, the target scent is explosives. In case of tuberculosis, they're positive sputum samples. Gradually, we make it more difficult. The animals walk in a harness. They learn to detect sources of explosives in the open. And later on, they detect real landmines in a minefield. At the end, before we ship the animals to operational sites, the animals undergo an accreditation test. They, in 2 consecutive days, they have to cover 8 boxes of 100 square meters each and have to find all the mines in all of these boxes, which is really difficult. Once they pass this test, they are shipped abroad and again in the country tested according to the same international mine action standards by an external party. It's really wonderful to see this interaction between the animals and the trainers. After the animals are ready, they actually follow their trainers back to the cage, just like a dog would do. This is actually our capacity of a mine action capacity in Mozambique 3 years ago, and this is our current capacity. I don't show this to actually blow the trumpet, but is to demonstrate that a small rat capacity, you see these people here on the side, a small rat capacity can enhance the output of a mine action operation considerably. And you have mechanical tools, you have manual operators with metal detectors, and all these are combined for a relatively slow, tedious process. Where the rats come in, they can speed up this process considerably and make it a lot cheaper. To give you an example, where a rat and their trainer combined can do 200 square meters in half an hour, for these same 200 square meters, you need actually 4 people to work an entire day with metal detectors to get that done. In combination, rats supporting operation with mechanical tools and manual operators, utilizing an innovative land release approach, we can actually enhance mine action and provide it at only 60% of the cost of traditional mine action operations. And we've been bringing this model now in several countries. Our headquarters are in Tanzania. Over the last 15 years, we have developed this technology to what it is now. We talk about detection rats technology, and really it is a technology because it's very standardized. We can train a rat in this place, send it abroad, and is there used by somebody else according to the same procedures. So we have operations in Tanzania. We have mine action operations in Mozambique and Angola. And we're also expanding into Southeast Asia in Thailand, Cambodia, and also in Myanmar, where there's a lot of residual landmines left. But let me talk a bit about the tuberculosis problem as well. And for the TB detection application, the animals don't get out of a setup, so they're not immediately in contact with patients. What we do is we collect samples from hospitals, put them in these cassettes, 10 by 10, and insert this cassette in this setup. And watch now carefully, because this goes really very fast. It's already at the 3rd sample, so the animal only needs a fraction of a second. It keeps the nose in the hole. The trainer is now providing a click sound, and the animal comes for a food reward. Again, very extremely simple. And then if you know that these folks have like a secondary level of education, then we provide them with a lot of skills, expertise, with which they can enhance their development and tackle those difficult, expensive detection challenges more independently. Look how the animal is actually continuing here. So it takes it continues where it had been rewarded. Here is an indication on another sample for which it will not be rewarded. Actually, in practice, this is an operational sample. We only reward them on known samples. This sample, after rat indication, will be reconfirmed by other techniques. But by using this method, we can actually enhance case detection by over 30% in the 17 hospitals that we work together with currently in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. And maybe we just go over the systems approach. So a patient with pulmonary complaints goes to a hospital for a microscopic test, microscopy which is not very reliable. We collect all the samples from these hospitals and bring them to a central facility unit, both the positives and negatives. We inactivate all these samples by heating them at 90 degrees for 30 minutes. We train the animals on indicating positive, known positive TB samples. Then the animals run through the setup with operational samples and pick out those that have been missed by microscopes. We then reconfirm this with a higher level of technology, a fluorescent microscope or a gene expert. And this algorithm together jointly increases case detection rate by over 30%. Now, the challenge we face is to find these people back. We're talking African urban slums. People all have a mobile phone, but they don't necessarily have a fixed address. So we trace people by means of mobile phones. And currently, we managed to reach some 70% of those people that have been detected by the rats, confirmed, to enroll into treatment. So if you compare rats and microscopes, who is then better? Well, simply, microscopy on a routine basis, and I'm talking simple light microscopy like they use in dispensaries in Africa, has less than 50% case detection rate. That's in terms of sensitivity. Traditionally, it's a highly specific, because it's a visualization technique, so it's a highly specific test. In combination with rats are, well, we tested 10 rats on a number of samples, and the average per rat was 67% in terms of sensitivity, still with a relatively good specificity of 94%. So using several rats together, we can actually have a highly sensitive test, and then using microscopy to confirm, we have both a highly sensitive and a highly specific test together. And really, I wanted to conclude this talk because it actually shows that, well, these 3,600 people that have been found by rats, the millions of square meters that we have been returning to populations, the thousands of landmines that we found in this process, and surprisingly, the tens of thousands of unexploded bombs and small arms and ammunition. If you look at the impact created by this purely, out-of-the-box thinking, let it be, but in essence, it is based on empathy and on respectfully approaching those natural resources and harmonizing with them in order to foster a better world. I think this can be an inspiring story for all. Thank you very much.